Hi everyone, it's Carol Johnston here, and I'm going to be presenting this webinar on structural integrity and fatigue in offshore wind. I'm supported by my colleagues, Becca Newton, who's running the webinar behind the scenes, and Ian Froman, who looks after the TWI's industrial members in the power sector, and he'll be running the Q&A session at the end. So just to go through the agenda, the webinar will last around 25 minutes, and I'll give a brief introduction to TWI, and then I'll set the scene and tell you which aspects of wind turbine structures the webinar will focus on. I'll then go through some specific challenges for offshore wind and discuss some of the aspects of welded joints which affect structural integrity and fatigue. And I'll finish by describing some of the research that TWI is doing to assist the wind industry. The session will finish with a Q&A session. So if any questions occur to you during the presentation, please type them into the Q&A box and we'll go through them at the end. So just to start it off, TWI is a research and technology organisation whose core strengths relate to materials and joining technology. As well as carrying out consultancy for single clients, we also do research and development through our core research programme, joint industry projects, as well as innovation centres and PhDs through NSERC, which is the National Structural Integrity Research Centre based at TWI. We also run training schools and provide certification. We have our headquarters in Cambridge, and we have several other UK offices with different areas of expertise. Our laser additive manufacturing and friction welding colleagues are based in Rotherham. In Port Talbot, we have our state-of-the-art NDT specialists. In Aberdeen, we have a training centre. And in Middlesbrough, we have our numerical modelling team, welding engineers, and our underwater welding training centre. Okay, so getting on to the fabric of the webinar. So just to set the scene, throughout this presentation, I'll use the term wind turbine to mean the complete structure, so that's everything that can be seen on those images on the screen, plus everything which is below the water. So the rotor, nacelle, blades, as well as the cabling for electricity transmission are obviously vital parts of the wind turbine, but I'm not really going to focus on those. The webinar will instead focus on the structural components that these parts sit on. So that's the tower, whose function is to put the rotor at the correct height to access higher wind speeds and so make the turbines most efficient, as well as the transition piece which sits on top of the foundation of whichever kind is employed. And so obviously the environment imparts loads to the structures, and the designer must account for these loads at the design stage to ensure that the structure will withstand the operational and extreme loads. In addition to the loads imparted on the rotor by the wind and by the wind and the rotor on the tower and foundation, obviously, additional forces are applied to the structure by the sea. and the marine environment also has the potential for enhancing corrosion, and so the structure sees the combined effects of applied loads and corrosion. I won't say much about corrosion during this webinar, as my colleague Ben Robinson recently gave a webinar on materials challenges for the offshore wind industry, where we went into a lot more detail of those aspects. I'll be focusing on structural integrity, and from my point of view, the tower is a large welded structure. At the bottom of the tower is usually a transition piece, and this is joined to a foundation. These days by a bolted internal ring flange, and the type of foundation depends on the water depth, and the foundations range from monopiles to tubular jacket structures, and now becoming more common and enabling wind turbines to be located in deeper water, floating foundations. And can be tethered to the seabed using mooring cables or chains. Obviously, in an ideal world, a designer would specify a design, including the geometry and the materials properties required for a structure to withstand the applied loads. The structure would be installed, it would operate as expected for the required design life, and then be decommissioned. However, particularly in relatively new and fast-moving industries such as offshore wind, there can be things which can be overlooked and that do affect the strength of fabricated components. And these aspects may not be adequately addressed or highlighted in existing standards, or perhaps the importance of these aspects may not have been specified in sufficient detail to fabricators. And these sorts of things potentially limit the life of a structure or mean that more maintenance than was originally anticipated is needed. So this presentation will describe some of these seemingly small but important factors which can have a large effect on the integrity of offshore wind turbine structures, and we'll focus on the joints and in the main structural components. But first of all, what are the main challenges for offshore wind? So wind turbine structures are very large structures, fabricated from carbon steel and containing welds and bolted joints. They're located offshore where access is not straightforward and they experience harsh environmental conditions. So there are some discrepancies between the physical size of the materials being used in offshore wind turbines and the basis of the design information in standards. For example, the SN curves in existing fatigue design codes are based on experimental data gathered on laboratory scale specimen thicknesses, and so they use a reference thickness of 25 millimetres, whereas the wall thickness of the base of a wind turbine tower can be anywhere around 50 millimetres thick. And since a thickness effect on fatigue strength has been documented, where the fatigue strength of welds in thicker plates is reduced, and a thickness correction is recommended in design codes, where this was based on analysis of fatigue strength of some welded plates on different thicknesses, this is an important aspect to remember. And similarly, the bolts used in wind turbine structures, for example, at the flange joint between the transition piece and the foundation, tend to be quite large, like M64 or M72, in order to withstand the large static loads that these structures are subjected to. These bolts are also subjected to fatigue loads. These bolts are also subjected to fatigue loads, and again, the design SN curve in the design standards are based on data from smaller bolts, and the size correction recommended in that is the same as that for welded joints. So there is some uncertainty over whether the fatigue strength of large bolts is as would be predicted by the design code. And so obviously being offshore, there's difficulties with access to wind turbine structures, both due to the fact that they're offshore, but also the large number of structures. And that means it's obviously preferable to reduce the amount of maintenance activity. And so there's a drive to improve reliability and reduce the probability of failure of components. So one aspect of improving reliability is to use the most appropriate data, which can enable better decisions to be made at both the design stage and during operation. So many of the design standards were developed for the oil and gas industry, and the procedures are targeted at structures used in that industry. And the wind industry, as I mentioned, has brought with it a paradigm shift in the size of components compared to oil and gas. And so improvements in the design standards are needed to make sure that the wind turbine designers are using the right guidance at the design stage. And a relevant aspect here is the position of the change in slope point of fatigue SN curves in the high endurance, low stress regime. Similarly, during operation, wind turbine operators do record a lot of data, and making use of that data recorded during operation can enable risk-based decision making in order to optimise inspection and maintenance intervals. So rather than being based on an arbitrary time interval, inspections and maintenance can be scheduled using risk-based criteria related to the probability and consequence of failure of a component. And then the last challenge that I've highlighted is that there's a global drive to produce more energy from wind. And so wind turbine designs are being optimised and improved on. And in only a few years, the industry has gone from almost exclusively using relatively simple monopile foundations to the point where now floating structures are in use. And this rapid rate of innovation means that there's a need to develop and commission new designs quickly. And so there's a need to transfer knowledge from other industries, such as oil and gas and maritime, and to avoid potential, in order to avoid potential pitfalls associated with the implementation of the new designs. But even with knowledge transfer, the wind industry is different to those other industries. The structures may be based on those used in oil and gas, but the fact that a wind farm is made up of many wind turbines, each with its own foundation structure, means that the foundations are commodities which need to be manufactured in large numbers at relatively low cost. And so fabrication methods are being employed which require tweaks to the original oil and gas designs. and these may produce unexpected flaws which might be detrimental to strength. So taking the example of tubular joints in jacket structures and fatigue strength, the SN curves for tubular structures in fatigue design codes were obtained from substantial test programs and analysis of data from tubular joints fabricated in the manner used in the oil and gas industry. So different fabrication methods are likely to produce different failure modes, which are not necessarily covered by the existing design SN curves. So now moving on, in the context of educating people who might not be very familiar with fatigue design or the significance of welds on fatigue design, I'll highlight some of the important aspects of welds that have a strong influence on structural integrity. So welds, and specifically arc welds, involve using a consumable which is melted by an arc to join two pieces of metal together. The resulting welds usually contain high levels of residual stress, and they may also contain flaws. And the heat input results in changes to microstructure relating to the weld, resulting in a heat-affected zone, and this may have different mechanical properties to the parent material and the weld. Welds are usually the weak link in terms of fatigue strength, and there are several reasons for this. So first of all, there are flaws, which are small slag inclusions at the toes of arc welds, and this has the effect of removing the initiation phase of the fatigue cracking process, and so reduces the overall fatigue life compared to that of unwelded parent material. At a weld, there's also often a change in cross-section, either due to the geometry of the joint or due to the presence of a weld cap, resulting in higher stresses at the weld region. There may also be misalignment at the joint, again producing additional secondary bending stresses, further reducing the fatigue life at the weld compared to unwelded material. And on top of all of that, welds can also contain flaws, such as lack of fusion or porosity. And flaws present in welds can be detrimental to their strength, to a level which might cause early failure of the structure when it's subjected to static or cyclic loads. Other types of joints, such as bolted connections, are also important. The image on the slide there shows a situation where a bolted plate has cracked due to fatigue. But in wind turbines, it's the fatigue strength of the bolts themselves that is important. So bolts or studs must be strong enough to resist the applied loads. And in bolted flange connections in wind turbine structures, these include prying forces from the tower wall tensile stresses, or when used to secure the foundations, the turning moments of the tower itself. So it's important that bolts resist the cyclic fatigue loads as well. If flaws are found in a weld, then fitness for service assessments based on fracture mechanics principles can be used to determine whether that flaw can be tolerated by a structure or not by comparing the resistance of the material in terms of its fracture toughness with the driving force for crack growth based on the flaw's dimensions, its location, and the applied loads. Otherwise, SN curves can be used to understand the fatigue performance of components, and they're particularly widely used for understanding the fatigue performance of welded joints. And TWI has a long history of structural integrity assessments and developed many of these concepts and procedures used by industry today through joint industry projects and other research projects. So, for example, fatigue tests and analysis carried out at TWI resulted in the first publication of the first SN curves to assist designers in the understanding of fatigue strength of different welded geometries. From this original work, TWI continued to develop the concept and the current British standard BS7608, which is a guide to fatigue design and assessment of steel products, is published and continues to be developed. BS7608 covers a range of industries where welded joints are used in different types of structures. The equivalent document published by DNB is DNB RPC 203, which is the fatigue design of offshore steel structures, and is more focused on offshore oil and gas structures. Its SN curves are also based on the original TWI work, and both documents have been added to over the years as new data became available, and much of that data was from qualification of new welding procedures for pipes used in the oil and gas industry. TWI also developed the concept of crack tip opening displacement as a means of measuring the resistance of steel to the propagation of a crack under load, and now CTOD is one of the main methods, a standard method for measuring and describing fracture toughness. And related to this, TWI has been and still is instrumental in developing the other British standard BS7910, which is the guide to methods for assessing the acceptability of floors and metallic structures, which describes procedures for carrying out fitness for service assessments, as I said, based on fracture mechanics principles. So now just going into a little bit more detail on some of those specific aspects that I've mentioned. The first one is residual stress. So welded joints contain a high level of tensile residual stress, and any applied stress is superimposed onto these tensile residual stresses, with the consequence that the weld experiences a fully tensile applied stress range, even if part of the applied load is compressive. And so the full stress range causes a fatigue crack to grow. And this is why SN curves in the fatigue design code use a stress range as opposed to stress amplitude, and also why the SN curves apply to all different stress ratios. Welds are separated into classes based on the geometry of the weld, the direction of the applied load with respect to the weld, and the level of inspection carried out, as well as the acceptance criteria, as that has implications for what floors are present in the weld. The fatigue classes were derived based on analysis of large sets of data, and the design curves were the lower bounds of that data, with a probability of failure of 2.3%. So it's obvious that attention must be paid to the fatigue class of the main welds in a structure, such as the girth welds, which joins sections of wind turbine towers together. But the fatigue performance is controlled by the weakest fatigue strength detail, and so welds joining attachments to the load carrying members can be a controlling factor. Often these are fillet welds, and these usually have a lower fatigue life for a given stress range than girth welds. So care is needed to ensure that welded attachments are located in regions of low applied stresses to avoid fatigue cracking from these details. As I mentioned, welds are split into different fatigue classes depending on the level of NDT inspection that's been carried out. And an example of this is that a girth weld in BS 7608 is classed as E if NDT has been used and the weld route has been found to be free of flaws, whereas a designer can only use class F2, which is two classes below with a fatigue life a factor of 2.4 lower if no NDT has been carried out. And so misalignment at a weld, referred to as high-low in pipelines in the oil and gas industry, can be caused by axial misalignment of adjacent pipe or by differences in wall thickness of the adjacent material. This high-low produces secondary bending stresses when a tensile load is applied to the weld, and that raises the stress locally at the weld. The fatigue classification of a weld is affected by the level of misalignment. So, for example, the F2 classification of a girth weld can be increased to E if the high load is less than 1 millimetre. And that limit was derived by analysis of pipe sizes and wall thicknesses relevant to pipelines. That's wall thickness is typically less than 25 millimetres and pipe diameters around 450 millimetres. Whereas in wind turbine structures, obviously a 1 millimetre misalignment on a 50 millimetre thick, 10 metre diameter structure is impossible. And fabrication standards limit misalignment to 3 millimetres currently, which is still an impressive feat of fabrication. But the important point is that limiting misalignment can be beneficial because it reduces secondary bending stresses and improves the fatigue strength of the joint. If it's not possible to reduce the stresses at a weld, then there are techniques which can be used to improve the fatigue strength of welded joints. Different techniques work by tackling the aspects which are responsible for the low fatigue strength of welded joints. So some techniques aim to remove flaws at the weld toe by blending the weld toe into the parent material using toe grinding, for example, or removing the weld cap entirely. The alternative approach is to introduce beneficial compressive stresses at the weld by techniques like peening, such as hammer peening or ultrasonic impact treatment. So weld toe dressing can give an improvement in the fatigue strength by a factor of 1.5 at high endurances of 10 million cycles, and the slope of the SN curve becomes shallower, so from a slope of 3 to 3.5. But if there's a corrosive environment, there may be less of a benefit because corrosion can produce pitch on the surface, which may turn into fatigue cracks. For welds where peening has been used, if the weld isn't subjected to high levels of tensile stresses in service, these which would cancel out the beneficial compressive stresses, then the technique can again produce a factor of 1.5 improvement on fatigue strength at 10 million cycles. So now just moving back on to some of the areas that I highlighted before, where there's a lack of information on materials and structures relevant to structural integrity of wind turbine towers and design codes. As I mentioned, this fatigue life improvement attributed to well-turned grinding or cap removal may not work very well in a corrosive environment, since corrosion can cause pitting of the surface. And the pit to crack transition is an area of active research. And at TWI, we have had two PhD students working on characterising the phenomenon. Through a combination of finite element analysis, experiments to produce data from simulated corrosion pits, and characterisation of those pits and fatigue cracks, fundamental understanding of the pit to crack transition has been developed. Work in this area is continuing with a core research programme project, which will focus on understanding the fatigue behaviour of real corrosion pits. Another aspect where data is missing in design standards is on the fatigue behaviour of large bolts. Again, TWI is running a core research programme project to generate fatigue SN data from large bolts. And this is supported by a PhD project whose focus is on understanding the mechanics of large bolted connections. And now that floating wind turbines are now a reality, and they continue to be used, suitable mooring systems are needed. So TWI ran a six-year joint industry project, which involved designing a test machine to conduct full-scale fatigue endurance testing on high-strength, large-diameter mooring chain in seawater. The testing work was supported by our NDT colleagues and NDT inspections of the chain and a PhD project where finite element analysis was used to gain a thorough understanding of how these high-strength mooring chains behave under fatigue loading. Now, TWI has this unique capability for performing corrosion fatigue tests on multiple links of full-scale mooring chain. And the research programmes that I've mentioned highlight TWI's focus on testing combined with modelling and an understanding of materials properties in order to understand the integrity and performance of structures. So testing is important because welded joints are particularly complex and it's difficult to capture all of the aspects which affect performance in a finite element model. So in addition to the specific test machines I've just mentioned in these research projects, we have lots of other testing facilities, including many other types of fatigue testing capabilities in air and different corrosive environments to allow us to produce SN curves as well as fatigue crack growth rate data. The fracture testing capabilities ranging from fracture toughness tests at ambient and elevated temperature in air and those tests in corrosive environments. And we also have the expertise to enable these tests to be applied to welded joints, which, as I've described, are complex. So that brings us to the end of the presentation. So here's the TWI website address and my contact details, as well as the email address to access our duty engineer. So please do take a look at the website where you can find out a bit more about what TWI can offer. And then that just brings us on to the question and answer session. So if you do have any questions, please type them into the Q&A box and we'll go through them. And my colleague Ian will help me with this part of the process.
Okay, thank you, Carol. I hope you can hear me. And thank you for your presentation. That's very good. Yes, there are a number of questions. So I'm going to start going through those and reading them to you, if you can provide an answer to those.
So
the first question we have is, what is the difference between oil and gas design and wind farm, which requires critical design?
So the differences, as I see them, are the differences in the consequence of failure. So obviously wind turbine structures are not manned, so the consequence of failure are potentially lower, but there are so many more of those structures compared to a single offshore structure. So you need a different approach to that design. And as I mentioned earlier, so designers want to make sure that their reliability is quite high so that they don't have to go and access and maintain and inspect these structures very often.
Okay, thank you. Is there a spec for inspection frequency of bolts and welds?
So the inspection frequency specifically?
Is there a specification for the inspection frequency and for bolts and welds?
I don't believe so, one that specifies the frequency. But the kind of best way to do it is using some kind of risk-based criteria where you do kind of look at the probability and consequence of failure and then work out with an appropriate safety factor what would be the most appropriate interval.
Okay, thank you. What could be the effect of misalignment above the permissible tolerances, e.g. for permitted 4mm but noted 8mm maybe on a transition piece flange to a transition piece cylinder weld or a jacket leg to a leg girth weld?
Yeah, that's a good question. So obviously the effect of misalignment is to add an extra stress concentration to the joint. So if you have a particular location that has a higher misalignment than elsewhere, then you'll have higher local stresses at that point. So there is a higher risk that fatigue failure would occur in that location as opposed to in other locations. But I think it's important to also understand what level of stress concentration you'll have due to a particular level of misalignment based on the overall size of the component. Because as I mentioned in the presentation there, when we think about oil and gas pipelines, we think about 1mm being a high level of high-low or misalignment in a weld, whereas obviously it's a completely different, we must be thinking about different levels of high-low to give the same level of stress concentration in a wind turbine structure.
Okay, thank you. I'm just going to say there is actually a huge volume of questions, which we will actually be taking a note of. So please apologise if we don't get through to all your questions today, but we will try and follow them up after as a separate email. I've got one here. What duration in a corrosive environment, i.e. seawater, would be required before corrosion pits are considered to be erroneous enough to warrant an SN curve downgrade?
That is also a good question. So that's something that we're going to be looking into and focusing on in more detail in the current projects that we're working on. So the research projects that I just mentioned involved simulating corrosion pits on pieces of carbon steel and then monitoring how they grow over time in a corrosive environment. I think it all depends on the specific environment, the temperature, the initial sizes. But it's something that we're looking into and researching.
Okay. It's been mentioned that bolted joints are critical. I was wondering if any failure mode is critical in particular, such as fretting fatigue, bolt failure, etc.
Well, my focus is always on fatigue behaviour. So the research that we're doing here is looking at the fatigue strength of these bolted joints. And the reason that we're interested in the fatigue behaviour of these joints is that obviously when joints are installed on a flanged connection, a particular preload is applied to those joints with the idea that the preload will protect those bolts from any cyclic fatigue loads and try and prevent fatigue failure. But over time, sometimes the preload might be lower than the expected value, which leaves bolts vulnerable to fatigue. So our focus is on the fatigue failure of the bolts.
Do you think fatigue failures in the industry can be traced to possible shortfalls introduced by stepping out from the intent of design standards due to limited structures or due to issues with fabrication and installation of larger sections and bolts?
That's an interesting question as well. I think as I tried to mention in the presentation, a lot of the recommendations in standards are based on kind of existing data and they've been developed over the years based on structures operating in particular environments or, you know, particular types of structures operating in particular environments, and a lot of them are based on oil and gas industry structures. Obviously, since wind turbine structures are relatively new in the scheme of things, there is a potential that the recommendations in the design standards are not quite appropriate for these wind turbine structures, and so that's where people like us and others doing research in this area are needed to get the data to make sure that these design codes are actually appropriate for these new structures.
Okay. One person here says, thank you for the presentation. I noticed a bolt fatigue testing image. Does TWI do full-scale fatigue testing of bolts? Up to what size? And can it be done in a corrosive environment, such as seawater with CP?
Partially, yes. So I showed a very large test machine. So the core research program project that we're running at the moment, we're testing M72 bolts under fatigue loading. And we are applying a corrosive seawater environment, but we're not submerging the bolts in seawater, so we're not doing submerged with CP, but we are exposing them to seawater.
Does TWI have any experience of NDT of operating wind turbine tower welds? If so, what techniques would you use?
Yes, we do. My colleagues in the NDT section do go out and do on-site inspections of wind turbine structures in general. I know that they've done a lot of inspections on the blades and the turbines itself. I don't see why they couldn't do inspections on the welded joints. Obviously, they are very experienced in doing inspections on the welded joints. So we can contact you specifically with some more information about that.
Okay, given the time, I'm going to just take a couple more questions. And as I say, I promise that we'll try and get back to everyone individually. This is an interesting one. Why do we use materials that are prone to fatigue failure? Aren't there any materials out there that are more resistant to fatigue cracking and more suitable for the purpose?
That is a good question. I think the problem is when you put a weld into any material, then you're going to be increasing the likelihood of a fatigue failure. Welds are particularly susceptible to fatigue for all of those reasons that I mentioned. If you could produce a structure out of one single piece of material, so I'm thinking single crystal turbine blades, for example, they're designed in a way to minimize fatigue failures. If you could come up with a wind turbine sized structure made of a single crystal, then maybe you could avoid fatigue. But unfortunately, anything where you have notches, flaws, stress concentrating features, they will end up being subjected to fatigue.
What part does corrosion protection have in reducing the effect of pitting and corrosion in general?
Obviously, if you've got the right system in place, then that will reduce the amount of corrosion that your structure is subjected to. But I think I would leave my corrosion colleague experts to give him on that part.
Okay. Well, I think that's sort of concluded the main questions. There is a lot there, and as I say, we will try and get back to people individually where we can, because as you can imagine, there's quite a lot of attendees today. It's a popular topic. Once again, I just wanted to say thank you to Carol for presenting this interesting topic. Just to say that this is actually part of a series of webinars that TWI is running in the offshore wind sector. We ran one last month on the materials challenges in offshore wind, and we're looking for suggestions of what other areas people would like to hear about. One of the areas that we're considering is looking at condition monitoring for offshore wind structures. It's another area which TWI has active research projects in. So if there's any further comments anyone would like to make, then please just pop us an email either to Carol Johnson or to myself, Ian Froment at twi.co.uk. Sorry, it's ian.froment. Then we'd be happy to take your questions. So again, thank you very much. And that concludes the end of our webinar this afternoon. Thank you.